Hi, my name's Ben Goodyear, Vicar of the Parish of Herne Hill. Welcome to our virtual service today. Coming up, we've got music from our parish musicians and choir, as well as from St Martin's scholars. Adjoa and O'Connell, one of our lay readers, is going to be finishing our sermon series of learning from women in the Bible. As we gather now, we'd like to welcome anyone who's new, who's never joined us before. We do hope that you enjoy the service and feel that you can encounter God as we gather together. Everything you need will appear on the screen. And we begin by starting our service in prayer, so please join in with me now. We're worshipping together, wherever we are, as the family of God, in our Father's presence, to offer him praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive his holy word, to bring before him the needs of the world, and to ask his forgiveness of our sins, and to seek his grace, that through his Son, Jesus Christ, we may give ourselves to his service. Amen. We begin by singing our first hymn, Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Sing like never before, oh my soul.
Now we come to a time of confession to reflect on our relationship with God. There may be things we want to say sorry to God for. So in a moment, we're going to have a time of quiet to bring those things specifically to God before confessing together. And so we confess together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we've sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. May the God of love and power and grace forgive us and free us from our sins, heal and strengthen us by his Spirit. Through Jesus Christ's name. Amen. And now a Bible reading from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, according to the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus. To Timothy, my dear son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve as my forefathers did with a clear conscience, as night and day I constantly remember you in my prayers. Recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I've been reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also.
What's in a name? So my name is Adjua, and in my father's tradition, anyone who is from the Fanti tribe in Ghana, West Africa, as my dad is, or who knows the Fanti language, would know by my name that I am of the Fanti tribe, that I am a girl, and I was born on a Monday. In the Fanti tradition, your day name, the day on which you first drew breath, is your first name. Names are full of meaning. Take, for example, Harry Kane, the England football captain. What does Kane mean? Well, Kane means little warrior, from the Irish kath, meaning battle. In Japanese, it means golden, and in Hawaiian, it means man. So, golden little warrior man. That's not bad for a sporting team captain. Or what about Brindley, like our Simon and Jenny? Well, it's found chiefly in Cheshire, Staffordshire and Lancashire, and Brindley comes from Old English, from burnt, meaning burnt, and lee, so burntly, meaning burnt clearing or woodland clearing. Or perhaps, as in Iceland, if you're a woman, your surname ends in dottir, meaning daughter. It gives you family connection. There's an actress in the John Wick film starring Keanu Reeves called Sigridur Benedictsdottir. Benedictsdottir. So, what's the name of her father, do you think? Benedictsdottir. Or perhaps your surname is Taylor or Mason or Baker, describing what your ancestor did for a living years gone by. So, names are rich with meaning. But remembering names can be tricky. I liked it when we used to have a name badge Sunday, when we would all write our names on sticky labels as we arrived at church, and with relief we could be reminded of the names we should know but couldn't quite remember, or if we were new, what a relief not to have to remember everyone's name all at once. Well, here's a series of names. Remember any of these? Any sound familiar? Hagar, Rahab, Deborah and Jael, Abigail, Jehosheba, Huldah, Anna, Joanna, Mary and Martha, Mary Magdalene, Dorcas, Phoebe, Lydia, Priscilla, Tryphena, Tryphosa, Persis. Yes, these are the names of just some of the women from the Bible whose stories we have been looking over the past 5 months in adult study and lately in our services together. A surprising number of women's stories in the Bible get neglected, and lots of their names are unknown even by those who think they know their Bibles pretty well. One study of the Bible produced a total of between 3,000 and 3,100 names, some have different variations for the same name, 2,900 of which are men, with 170 of the total being women. And a study of women whose spoken words are recorded found only 93 women, of which 49 are named. Just 49. There were 8 people on Noah's Ark with all the animals, but none of the wives are named. I introduced this series, Women in the Bible, in April, hoping we might all become a bit more familiar with the names and stories of women in the Bible. And this morning, I will finish up with 2 more names, Lois and Eunice, a mother and daughter from Lystra, now in present-day Turkey. But before I do, what other women's names can anyone think of from the Bible? How about Eve, Susanna, Naomi, Bathsheba, Elizabeth, Dinah, Hannah, Jezebel, Ruth, Sarah, Rebecca, Michael, Leah, Rachel, Miriam, Esther, Delilah, Maccabee, the Queen of Sheba, Judith, Salome, Tamar, Keziah, Hephzibah, Tabitha, and Zuleika? So what's in a name? Why is it important to be known by name? God speaks to the Jewish nation in exile after the fall of Jerusalem. They've been exiles and treated appallingly for many years, but things are beginning to shift. And through Isaiah, meaning God is salvation in Hebrew, God encourages his people to keep their courage, to hold their nerve, to trust that all would come right through him. In tough times, God knows our name. As we read in Isaiah 43, verses 1 to 3, God says, "Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have saved you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Saviour." If we are lost without a name, how can someone call for us? Without a name, how can we call for someone? Without a name, how can we identify or be recognised? How can we recognise or identify someone else? Names give us a place in the world. They give us a history and a connection. I said all those names of women in the Bible, so maybe you might remember some of them. Maybe have a look and a read for yourself. Carry on finding out more about them. I've been thinking about Afghanistan this morning, about the countless women whose names we do not know, whose choices will disappear along with their names, from newspaper offices and schools and hospitals and universities and laboratories and law courts, as women and girls are forced back into the home, away from education and careers, allowed out only if accompanied by men from their families, visibly disappeared beneath full covered burqas. May we remember those women and girls and the men and boys who love them in our prayers. To allow people their names is to recognise their existence as unique creations and to celebrate them. So to the names of our final 2 women this morning, Lois and Eunice. I am very happy to celebrate Lois and Eunice, as my mother's middle sister is Lois And we have our own dear Eunice, a faithful member of our St. Paul's congregation here in Herne Hill. In fact, I am sure there are many biblical namesakes in our congregation and the parish beyond. So, what's the meaning of the name Lois? It comes from the Greek, meaning more desirable or better. And Lois has a daughter called Eunice. If she'd been Icelandic, maybe she would have been called Lois Dottir. But she isn't Icelandic, she's Jewish. But she's called Eunice from the Greek. Eu, meaning good, and Nike, victory. A good victory. Perhaps Lois was delighted to have a daughter and celebrated that with her name. Eunice, a good victory. So, why does the Bible draw our attention to Lois and her daughter Eunice? Well, Eunice and her husband and her mother Lois raise a son called Timothy. Unusually, we learn from Acts chapter 16, verses 1 to 3, that Timothy was of mixed heritage, we are told. Paul came to Derbe and then to Lystra, where a disciple named Timothy lived, whose mother was Jewish and a believer, but whose father was Greek. We know that Mum Eunice loved God, which she learnt from her mother Lois, for she and her mother raised Timothy to love God too. And to show that, Eunice named him Timothy from the Greek name Timotheos, meaning honouring God, or in God's honour, or honoured by God. What's in a name? A lot. Paul reminds Timothy in his letter from his prison cell in Rome, in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15. From infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. So Timothy came to love Jesus because of his childhood upbringing from infancy, and the love of God, grandmother Lois and mum Eunice passed on to him. As a result, Timothy brought many people to Jesus as he supported Paul's missionary work, even undergoing the painful operation of circumcision as an adult. We read in Acts 16, verse 3, for the sake of the mission work, Acts tells us, so he, Paul, circumcised him because of the Jews who lived in that area, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. If Timothy was circumcised, as was the practice of all Jewish men, then Jews would listen to his preaching, even though his father was Greek, and non-Jews would listen to him because his father was Greek. Because of Lois and Eunice, Timothy was a perfect person to join Paul in spreading the good news about Jesus across the mainly non-Jewish congregations of what would be modern-day Italy, Greece, Albania, Macedonia, Bulgaria, Turkey, Egypt, and Lebanon. And later, after Paul was imprisoned for the final time in Rome, Timothy would continue Paul's work at the church in Ephesus as their pastor. Paul writes to him in this morning's reading from verse 5. I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. Timothy certainly lived up to his name, honouring God and honoured by God in his life's work. Timothy was raised in the faith from infancy, and the seed of his own faith blossomed. I reflect on how, for many who are raised in a faith community, how often we may drift off and come back, and how God is still waiting, holding our name badge, waiting to welcome us home. Perhaps that may be an encouragement for those of us who, as parents, godparents, carers, and friends, have raised drifting children or who drifted ourselves. God's love is unwavering, even when we ourselves waver. Our name is known by him forever. And when our name is called by God, will we answer the call? Do we see each other Do we take time and trouble to recognise our fellow human beings, our brothers and sisters under God's creation, to name each other, to see our gifts? If we read on in this chapter, Paul says in verse 6, "For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands." He sees the gift of God in Timothy that came from the faith he was raised in by Lois and Eunice. And he encourages Timothy to follow his gift, to listen to God's call, fan the gift from a spark to a flame, so that all who hear his words will catch fire with the excitement of learning about a God who loves them and wants justice and peace for their lives. I'll be speaking more about this in October when we reflect upon what God might be calling us to do, just as he called Timothy, a son and a grandson blessed at birth with a name expressing the faithful love of his mother and grandmother for God in unsettled times. For their home, from their home, in the collapsing Roman Empire, Lois and Eunice kept faith with God. In the risky growing church at Ephesus, the young pastor Timothy kept faith with God. And from his dank Roman prison cell, facing impending death, the aging apostle Paul kept faith with God. They answered the call of their hearts and named Jesus their faithful Saviour, believing in the God of love and justice and peace. I hope that going forward as a church, we may no longer need a whole series naming women whose contributions to the rich history and examples of our faith we see here and we have been studying. I hope that women's lives and names will simply become a familiar part of our collective Christian learning in church, reflecting the rich contribution made by the women of our own congregations and our own communities. Before we finish, may I ask that you think of the name of someone known to you or not, and offer a prayer for that person by name, in a quiet moment now. And now a prayer for all of us. Creator God, may we take encouragement from these faithful children of yours, Lois and Eunice, and the boy they raised, Timothy, and Paul, who recognised Timothy's gift from you and encouraged him. May we learn, remember and value the contribution of those named and unnamed women in our faith story. For as you reminded the Israelites in exile, we should not fear, for you have saved us. You have called us by name. We are yours. Amen.
We now have a moment of quiet prayer to bring our thoughts and reflections to God before joining in together with the Lord's Prayer. And so we say together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. In response to Adjua's sermon, we now sing together, "Here I Am, Lord."
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save.
I who made the stars of night, I will make the darkness bright, who will bear my light to them, whom shall I save?
As we come to the end of our service now, I do invite you to visit our website, hernhillparish.org.uk, for full details of what's going on in the parish at the moment. All of our services are going to be resuming again in September, including our children's church at our 9:30 a.m. and 11:15 services. But we do have some other news that I'd like to share, and so I'm going to hand over now to Susan Wright, our curate.
Hello. I wanted to give you some advance notice of some discipleship opportunities that are coming this autumn. First of all, we are delighted to announce that we're planning a confirmation service with full immersion baptisms and renewal of baptism vows this autumn at the 5 at St Paul's. We'll let you know the date when the bishop confirms. Baptism and confirmation are a wonderful way to publicly affirm your faith and deepen your relationship with Jesus, and we are so pleased to be able to offer this opportunity. If you think this is something that you or your young person might be interested in, please do speak to me. You can call me on 07706 755018, or my email is susan@hernhillparish.org.uk. And do please be praying for our candidates. But that's not all. Alpha and Youth Alpha are coming to Herne Hill this September. The Alpha course is a great opportunity to think for yourself and ask your questions about life, faith, and Jesus. Alpha has something for everyone. Whether you've never really thought about faith or why you go to church, or you're ready to go deeper. Alpha is also a great preparation if you're thinking about baptism or confirmation. The Alpha course for adults will run on Zoom from Thursday the 23rd of September. And Bex will be running Youth Alpha for young people at St Saviour's Church from the 9th of September, and they'll get supper as well. Full details of both of the courses are on the church website. If you want to find out more about what Alpha involves, you can go to their website, alpha.org. To sign up for Alpha, contact me, or for Youth Alpha, contact Bex. We hope to see some of you there, and we hope all of these events will be a blessing to our parish. Thank you.
And now we finish our time together by saying the words of the grace. Words will appear on the screen. So now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.